Stay tuned. In our next segment, we hope to answer the question, why is Mona Lisa smiling?
Good afternoon. I'm Wanya Lucas, and I'm the president and CEO of Crown Media Family Networks, also known as the Hallmark Channels. And now I'm thrilled to be here today to moderate this discussion of the film, Why is Mona Lisa Smiling? The Reimagination of the Corporation. So let's get started. Let's now hear from one of the filmmakers and the WBC Trailblazer awardee, Joey Reiman. Joey?
Thank you. Wanya, let me set the stage for you. And it's a great segue from BCG, because before I joined Brand New World, I was a fellow at the Institute, the Henderson Institute at BCG. And my focus was the Renaissance and why the Renaissance came about. And I really, you know, focused on this amazing time when thousands, actually 40,000 Greek refugees marched into a place called Florence. And instead of being met with adversaries, they were met by the Medici family, who at that time, well, the Medicis were like Bill Gates. It was the most lucrative company in the world, and it was a bank. And they did something that no company had ever done before. They backed these artisans. They backed these refugees who were carrying books called the Humanities. And then I joined Brand New World. I shelved my work on the Renaissance until the pandemic came about. And that's when I had the revelation. You see, during 15th century Florence, there was this thing called the Black Plague, which wiped out 2/3 of the world. And it was interesting that we had something horrible like the Black Plague. We had no Dr. Fauci, no CNN, but we also had an enlightenment, the end of feudalism and the beginning of capitalism. So think about how this is, the parallels here are amazing. Something horrific, the death knell of a Black Plague, something horrific, the pandemic, and something incredible, enlightenment of the corporation, and a rebirth of what business is all about. And that rebirth is what this film is all about. It's about how the role of business will actually expand its orbit of caring to include others, not just shareholders, but stakeholders, and how this will be, again, a time of enlightenment when things like shipping and art and public space and the printing press come about. I mean, this is probably the second most important time in the history of business. And best of all, here we have Leonardo da Vinci, an amazing painter, an amazing sculptor that does something in the 15th century that no painter had ever done before. And that's put a smile on a portrait called the Mona Lisa. And that smile was symbolic of the optimism of the time, of the merriment, he called the merriment of the time, when the Black Plague was ceasing and invention was on the forefront. So the question becomes, who will be the Renaissance leaders now? Who will be the Renaissance men and Renaissance women who will give a rebirth to business and a reimagination of the corporation?
Thank you.
So Eileen, this film is about the reimagination of the corporation.
Good, it's time.
We're in a particular point in our, I think, the evolution of our history where people have really lost faith in almost all institutions.
Much of which
depending on who you talk to, was directly the fault of capitalist pigs who just wanted to take big bonuses, and there's a ton of greed, and it wasn't kept in check. And that is where capitalism can get out of hand.
The risk is that if people do not see a better future for themselves in the way the community at large is operating, they're going to want to try a different model.
Something that was devised 100 years ago may not be the best thing for today. So you've got to find your way to amend that. And I think capitalism needs guide rails. It needs the ability to say, it's not just about the shareholder, but it's about everybody else.
It's what sort of people today demand. And I just don't think there's survival without doing better.
A corporation that believes its sole reason for existence is to maximize shareholder value is, in today's world, an exceedingly dangerous entity.
So there are still a lot of CEOs, investors that say, this stakeholder capitalism thing is not a good idea. What do you say to those people?
No, I think I respect their opinion. I think they're wrong. It's like dinosaurs. They disappear mainly because they couldn't adapt rather than because something hit them.
In a time when the Black Plague threatened civilization, a family-owned bank would spark the most innovative age in history.
This pandemic, like the Black Plague, has really forced everybody to completely shift.
The way that we measure a civilization is through the humanities. Languages, art, literature, these are the things that the Renaissance realized really mattered more than just money.
The pandemic was that timeout and trigger to really step back and examine.
There is an opportunity to capitalize on this moment to make the world a better place.
We're going to use our position to create a more inclusive society. Racial inclusion, economic inclusion, gender inclusion.
We had just had a massively big press conference with the governor announcing that we were moving in to North Carolina. They gave us the bowl of North Carolina. And 2 weeks later, they passed a so-called bathroom bill, which it allowed for the potential discrimination against somebody for their sexual identity. And I literally walked out of my office and said, we're going to pull out of North Carolina within a week. They asked for the bowl back and we couldn't find it.
Somebody once said to me, like, you live life with a sense of urgency. And I'm like, why shouldn't I? Like, I don't know what world you live in, but it needs to change fast.
The World Economic Forum said it would take 117 years to reach gender parity. And we said, no, we'll all be dead.
You know the concept of preventative medicine versus going to the ER? In sort of the agriculture and climate worlds today, we're constantly in ER mode.
It's about the land. If we want healthy people, we have to have healthy land. If we want healthy land, we have to take care of it. Fundamentally, the way we've done it for the last 50 years has to evolve.
We've launched a collection which has cotton blended with hemp. Hemp is a much more sustainable fiber because hemp requires a lot less land and a lot less water to grow. It's a weed. It is weed.
It's easier to reimagine the corporation than have it reimagined for you.
Exxon has been notoriously slow to recognize the changes we're talking about. And what happened to them? An activist investor who cares about the climate has picked off 3 seats on their board. The world is changing, and if you don't change with it, you're going to be knocked out.
From Fortune Media and brand new World Studios comes the most important business film of our time. A deep dive into a broken system. As told by the visionaries who are reimagining the way we do business.
A little over 20 years ago, I was on a spiritual retreat. The spiritual leader came up to me at the end and said, I hope you know the good you can do, because business will someday be the greatest force for good in the future. If you choose to do so, you can do a lot of good. And it was like one of these blinding moments of clarity. And we had just done the Easy Breezy Beautiful Cover Girl campaign.
and our spokespeople were too young, too thin, and too white. And I thought, we need to change that.
Featuring Anjay Banga, Chip Berg, Mark Bertolini, Jim Coulter, Jeff Dunn, Eileen Fisher, Edie Frazier, Rebecca Henderson, Margaret Keane, Rob Lake, Ellen McGurk, Sarah Menke, Alan Murray, Mark Pritchard, William Rogers, Ginny Rometty, Dan Shulman, and more.
I do believe we are on the cusp of a Renaissance moment.
I have a lot of hope that the change is happening fast enough.
It's time for action and to be held accountable. And it's happening.
We'll create a better place, and a better place for everyone.
The last time a plague met purpose-driven business, Leonardo da Vinci gave Mona Lisa a smile. Who will ignite the 21st century Renaissance and make the whole world smile?
The idea that business could save the world, how eccentric could you get? But here's the thing. I think we're in a desperate place. And I don't think we have many other ideas.
Alan, you're on mute.
Classic, right? How many times a week do we do that now? My name's Alan Murray. I'm the CEO of Fortune. I'm one of the executive producers of Why is Mona Lisa Smiling? And as a journalist, I've been covering the intersection of business and society for four decades. And what became clear to me over the last few years was that something very different is going on. The CEOs I talk with are talking about, thinking about, and acting on their responsibilities to society in very different ways than they did in the past. Some of it's the result of pressure from their employees. Some of it is a reaction to the failure of government to effectively address so many of these problems. You've begun to see pressure from consumers, pressure from investors. And some of it reflects fundamental changes in the way business operates. Let me give you an interesting fact. 50 years ago, if you looked at the balance sheets of Fortune 500 companies, you would see that 80% of the value or more was in stuff. It was plant, equipment, buildings, oil in the ground, inventory on the shelf, physical stuff. And having access to that stuff, to capital, was what gave you power in the marketplace. If you do the same exercise today, look at the balance sheets of Fortune 500 companies, what you will see is 85% of the value comes from intangibles, from intellectual property, from the value of the brand, all things that are rooted in not physical capital, but human capital. And so in a way, what's happening in business today is exactly what happened to architecture and art in the Renaissance. It's becoming more human. Human capital has become the key to corporate success. And inspiring people, motivating people, providing moral leadership, giving them a North Star has become more and more important to running a successful business. And that's really what we're trying to capture in this firm. And of course, diversity is an important piece of that new puzzle. When you're talking about human capital, you obviously have to pay attention to half the population. Diversity for women has been way too slow moving at the top of corporate America. Again, look at the Fortune 500. Only 8% of Fortune 500 CEOs today are women, but it's moving. It's moving slowly, but it's starting to move. And I want to thank the WBC for what it's doing in that area. It makes a difference. So in closing, the one thing I'd like to point out, Edie, is that yesterday Fortune appointed the first female editor-in-chief in our 92-year history. So we're doing our little part. I think this film will help push things forward. The world is changing.
Hello, I am Joanna Durr. I am the director of the film. This film is the passion project of my life. My background is not as a director. It is not in film. My background is in business. And I believe deeply that business can be a force for good in the world. I believe that corporations can and should do better than they've been doing for the last couple of decades. And this film is about telling the story of how and why business can do better. I think corporations are fascinating institutions because in the world, there are very few things that are as good at directing resources to solve big problems and address real challenges. I mean, that's what they do incredibly well. And to steal Colin Mayer's comment, a corporation's value comes from people and the planet. So it is self-enlightened interest that corporations would try to solve the problems and address the challenges that people and the planet are facing. And I think that's the awakening that's happening across CEOs right now, across the business world right now. You know, I think we want the film to be inspirational, of course, but we also want it to be a little bit instructive and hopefully influential too, that it will get other business thinkers acting and leading in this way, along the lines of purpose-driven business, along the lines of stakeholder capitalism. And I think that's really, you know, the power of film, to be both inspirational and instructive. And maybe to Edie's point, the comment she made in the trailer there, hold people accountable. But in kind of in the light of speaking to the power of film, I'll introduce Brad Siegel, one of our executive producers.
Hi, thanks, Joe. I think for us at Brand New World Studios, this is the first feature documentary that we'll be releasing. And I have made hundreds of films and series over my career in television and film. And I think this is perhaps the most important one I've ever been involved in. It's a story that needs to be told. It's a story about how business is going to be the life force of changing society. As the previous speakers had mentioned, government, religious institutions in the past had been left to do that. And now it's business taking those reins once again. And in this film, we meet CEOs from major corporations, Fortune 500, 1000s, but also from startup corporations. And how they are embracing purpose and how they are embracing change and moving from shareholder capitalism to stakeholder capitalism. I do think this is one of the most important business films of our time. And that's why we said we can't wait for anyone to back this film. We're going to pay for ourselves. So Brand New World Studios has made our big investment in this film. It will be released in first quarter or early second quarter of next year. It will go to film festivals and to the top 25 business schools, and really hopefully all the business schools around the country for premiere screenings before it goes into general release. So I think that's, let's turn it over to Wanya now.
Great, thank you so much. Clearly there is passion and there is purpose when you think about this film. And so, Joanna, I want to go to you. Joey talked about the parallels between the Renaissance and what's happening in the world today. And can you elaborate a little bit and talk about the parallels that you're seeing in this current business environment? And also, can you explain why you feel this is really an important storyline?
Sure. So, you know, Joey mentioned, and I think obviously the most self-evident one is the pandemic relative to the Black Plague that they suffered, that kind of led to a lot of self-reflection at that time and led to a lot of self-reflection for us at this time, including in the business world. On the heels of that, I think there is the self-enlightened interest of corporations, and that parallels really what happened with the Medicis, right? That feudalism wasn't going to work anymore when 3/4 of the population had been wiped out. But the third thing that I think is really interesting, and Joey mentioned the printing press, the impact of the printing press during the Renaissance was the democratization of knowledge and power. And we have a similar technology that we're living with these days in the internet, specifically social media, that has led to a democratization of knowledge and power. It's led to transparency. It's led to new voices being heard. And I think that, that combination of things really lays the groundwork for something different. The other thing, though, that I learned in the context of these conversations, specifically talking with a Renaissance historian, there was a sense in the Renaissance, among the leaders, among the Da Vinci's and the Michelangelo's of the world, they knew they were changing something. They knew something was happening that was different. And there's among the CEOs of the big companies, there's certainly that recognition, but especially the next generation of entrepreneurs that are building for profit, for good organizations, they know they're changing something. They know that what will come is going to be different than what is now. They understand the tools that they have at their fingertips to kind of solve these problems. And that's inspiring. I mean, it's creating something new and an awareness of it. And I think that's really what's important.
Incredible. And so, Joanna, you talked about, you talked about this next generation. And so I want to turn the next question over to Alan. And the question is about, you know, this film, which really it talks about the changes in the business world and some of which we've heard already, but what do you think about the role of women as it relates to this change? We just heard about the next generation of leaders and how they're leading. What are women doing?
Well, a couple of things. One is, I think there are some prominent women in leadership positions that are driving the change. I mean, I love the conversation that Joe and I had with Eileen Fisher, who you saw in the trailer of the film. Ginni Rometty, who was CEO of IBM, was one of the people leading the effort at the business roundtable to change the statement of corporate purpose that had an important part of this. So I do think women, I don't want to slip into gender stereotypes, but it does seem that there have been a number of women who have played an important role in saying to corporations, hey, you really have to pay more attention to your responsibilities to society and your responsibilities to the planet. So I think that's one thing. But then the other thing is, as I said earlier, this is really all about human capital. And a business world that isn't making full use of the incredible female talent that's coming in is simply not doing its job. You can't expect to survive and thrive without using the best of what we have to offer in terms of human capital. And so I do see a new seriousness among corporations around their programs for women and for diversity and inclusion generally. Time will tell whether it makes the kind of impact it needs to, but it's clearly an increased focus from what existed a few years ago.
Right. Thank you so much. You know, it's really, I will start by saying, full disclosure, I'm a beneficiary of a man who really did give me my first chance in the media business, and that is Brad Siegel, where our next question is going to go. Brad, who saw something in me as a woman, as a person first, but as a woman and as a woman of color many years ago. So Brad, this conversation is still happening in many conference rooms, in the media, but also on Zoom calls. And, you know, we've heard a lot about why this film is important. Can you speak specifically why you think this film is different and why we need this film right now?
Yeah, I think it's different because one, so many CEOs stepped up to engage in this conversation, and both in major corporations and in startup corporations, and I think that Alan and Joanna held their feet to the fire. I mean, they asked hard questions. This film is not a platform for their propaganda. I mean, we pushed and pushed and pushed to make sure that it wasn't just sort of they're checking the box in how they're dealing with their stakeholders. We pushed them to show us exactly what they're doing, not just tell us what they're doing. So you will hear and see in the film what corporations across the world are doing. And you'll also see the difference and hear the difference between the startup companies and the mid-sized companies and you know, the giants of industry. And we'll get to hear from some naysayers also. And I think that was really important. This isn't just one-sided. We're hearing from people who don't buy it, who just say, you know what, it's always going to be about the shareholder, and we need to hear their voice as well. But I think it's important because this will stimulate thinking among hopefully young people starting out in business and really help them think through the issues that they're going to face as business leaders and just people in business. You know, it doesn't have to be a leader. It could be people, anybody making decisions anywhere along the business ladder. These are important things to be thinking about. And hopefully this film will shine a light on how to dimensionalize the things that we need to think about in the future.
Yeah, I love when you say anyone up and down the ladder can be make a difference, right? And really starting to plant that seed pretty early is empowering. So now I'm going to turn to Joey. Joey, what role do you hope or expect this film will play in driving change?
I think it'll be an incredible catalyst for change. And it will also give people permission to do something that they had not done before, which is be courageous enough to expand their orbit of caring to include others. I think it's going to rewrite the rules of business. And, you know, this goes back, I get a lot of credit for this movement, but, and, but in addition to this A team that has just shared their perspective, I want to bring up another A, the guy who started this whole thing, which was Aristotle, who back in 5 BC said, where your talents and gifts intersect with the needs of the world, there lies your vocare. Vocare is Latin for my role in the world and a calling, not a job, not a career, which are both too small for people's spirits, but a calling. And I think that that's what this film will do, something will do more than anything else, which will call people to step up and move beyond goods and services to doing good and doing service.
Yeah, change is great. And I think one of the things that excited me early on when you were talking, Joey, was the fact that this is going to be shown in business schools all over
yes.
the country. And as when I was in business school, it was all about greed, you know, Walt. So I am super excited that we are going to expose the young people to this concept. It's important. So Joanna, from your perspective, what have you learned from the interviews that surprised you the most?
So I've learned so much from the interviews. I mean, certainly kind of the concrete change that's happening. But honestly, the thing that I think surprises me the most because of the people that we are interviewing is the vulnerability and the humanity, the willingness to say, I don't know all the answers. When you hear that from CEOs in this context, this willingness to, that is surprising, you know, and to Alan's point about the next evolution of capitalism, the next ethos of the corporate world is really around humanity. When you hear that vulnerability, that willingness to admit that I don't know everything, when you hear that from the top, there's something reassuring about that because it is human, right? It is human. And I think knowing that the CEOs are thinking deeply about it to a point where they're not owning all the answers or saying, I know what the end state will be. I think that's promising. I think that's hopeful. Because I think that means others will ultimately end up at the table in that conversation.
Yeah, hope springs eternal. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna turn to our trailblazer for the final question. So Joey, when you look at where we are and the progress and the lack of progress, and Alan mentioned that we have more female CEOs of Fortune 500 companies than ever before, but really they only represent 8%. So there's more work to be done. So what gives you pause? I mean, what do you see as obstacles in the shift toward a more inclusive capitalism? And the counter to that is what gives you hope?
Well, I was just talking about this in class today. I'm a professor at Emory, and I've been teaching purpose for the last 20 years. Wow. And that question came up this morning, actually, like, when do we start? And I said, we're much too late. For me to be teaching MBAs and BBAs is outrageous. This is the first time they've heard of purpose. And, you know, great leaders are dealers in hope, and purpose is about hope, but it should start in grammar school. I said the other day, less dolls, more fire trucks. We start creating what people call sheeple. You know, they're following, you know, just a codified system that is really most of the time a meritocracy, when they should be learning about nurturing and empathy and compassion and love and forgiveness in second and third grade. I mean, there's a wonderful little story called Little Miss Flint about a young 8-year-old who wrote to Barack Obama about the water systems in Detroit, in Flint, Michigan. And he read the letter, got on his plane, went to see Little Miss Flint, who's 8 years old, and gave Flint, Michigan $100 million. That's amazing. She's 8 years old. So here's a dealer in hope. And that gives me pause to say, you know what, if we just educated and celebrated purpose earlier, we wouldn't be in the mess that a lot of us are in.
I love that. I love that so much. It is absolutely where we should be as a country. And so as we look to wrap up this panel, I'd like to ask the brand new studio, World Studios team, if you could share any final comments. And I'll start with you, Brad.
This film is the embodiment of who we are as a studio. Our purpose is to heal and repair the world, and our mission, which is what we do as compared to why we do it, is to tell meaningful stories that positively impact people's lives. And I think that this film and our partnership with Fortune in creating the film accomplishes both purpose and mission. So I'll leave it at that.
And Joey, first of all, I want to sit in one of your classes, but any final comments from you?
Yeah, I think we picked the right name, Brand New World Studios, because this is clearly a brand new world. And I think that that was a good decision. It reminds us of our greater purpose, which is to repair and heal the world.
Well, thank you all. And thank you to those who are watching today. I'd like to thank the panel for this amazing film preview and really for tackling what is a very important subject and really focused on our future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thanks to the WBC and Edie.
Thank you. Yep.
Thanks, Wanya.
Thank you, Wanya.